Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Joanna Nesseth. I'm Senior Vice President for Strategic Planning here at CSIS, and I co-direct our project on U.S. leadership and development. So we're glad that you could all be here with us today. This is actually a part of our series called the Chevron Forum on Development. Chevron has been partnering with us to really look at more innovative ways to bring business operations and the business community into development activities. But I don't think anyone would have anticipated that we'd be having this discussion linked to a development conversation. And I want to explain that a little bit and then introduce our panelists, because we've got very deep and very interesting topic to discuss today. As part of our work, what we've been trying to say is, let's get beyond corporate social responsibility, let's get beyond sort of project-based spending, and really look at where companies and the business community can have a stronger, more lasting impact on development. And if you take a look at some of the supply chain spend for company operations in a particular country, it's in the billions of dollars, whereas a CSR spend would maybe be a few million. And we have actually produced a paper this year. Michael Levitt is the author of the paper, and we'll hear from him in a little bit. But we put it out in front. It's really looking at maximizing the development impact of local content. So that led us to think and look for places and people who are really exercising this set of activities, where you're looking in a particular region or a country to say, who are the local suppliers, who are the small businesses, how can we get them up to spec and start selling to the American companies or American entities. So that's when we happened to get to know the folks at TWI, and we've got with us Jake Frazer from TWI and Boban also with TWI. And they told us about a very unique partnership with GSA that they had been participating in, and it was an effort to really look at how you actually source locally for some of the efforts in Central Asia. So we are so delighted today that the folks at GSA, Ken Latta, and then, Joel Lundy, are with us from GSA to talk about this, because this is a really unique set of operations. It's a unique approach, and we're hoping that we can draw out some of the lessons that they've learned over the course of their partnership and think about how they might apply and how they might be used in other areas around the world, and how other agencies like USAID can try to support companies that are doing this type of local spending or local operations. So with that, I'm not going to introduce them further, because I think you've got their bios in front of you, but I want to jump right into a set of questions. We're going to just sort of have a dialogue with the folks up here, have them explain how the process works. And once we've gone through sort of a little bit of dialogue, I want to open up to all of you. I know we tend to be blessed with an extremely knowledgeable, sophisticated crowd, so I'm sure you'll have very good questions and comments to offer. But welcome, and I'm going to start out talking to our folks from GSA. So let's talk about where all of this started. So you had to respond to a policy decision from the Department of Defense. They had asked you to increase the amount of local sourcing, or sourcing done within Central Asia, in support of the U.S. military in Afghanistan. And you awarded a supply chain integration contract to TWI. This is in 2010. And you've engaged in a very intense way to do some serious regional procurement. So that's a little bit of background. I wanted to ask if you could speak to that and talk about how you concluded this was really important and how you started moving down the path of this very unique model.
Thank you. I'm going to take a little bit of time at the beginning to give you a little bit of history and how this came about. And if I do a good job with that, hopefully that will save time as we go through the rest of it, that you'll have this basic information. And before I answer specifically the two questions that you're asking, I'll assume that most everyone here already knows that the discussion here takes place against the backdrop of DOD's establishment of land supply routes through Central Asia starting in late 2008, and the realization that purchasing supplies from the countries through which the supplies flowed was very attractive, both from a relationship and a logistics standpoint. So that's the precipitating event that's going on. Now, the really short answer to the question of why we thought it was important and how do we get to the first steps with TWI, really quick answer is, it was important because DOD asked us, and I'm going to explain why that's important in a second. And then how do we establish the relationship with TWI? The short answer is that we established a services contract with TWI. So this is, although we are purchasing supplies from Central Asia, we have a services contract with TWI. Now let me back up and just give you a little basic background information that will help you. The legislation that established GSA in 1949 and following that, a second piece of legislation in 1952, National Catalog and Standardization Act, established something that we refer to as the National Supply System. And if you'll lock onto that in your minds, there's two aspects of that that will help you understand my answer that I just gave to the question. Under this legislation, GSA was directed to establish a supply system in partnership with DOD. Okay, so there's one system. And then a very important aspect of that system is that the types of products that were classified under the Cataloging Act, are we have divided responsibilities. So GSA is assigned a certain and important piece of that pie, if you think of that circle. And our commodities, office products, industrial cleaners, hand tools, furniture, fiberboard boxes, bulk paper goods, those types of products are the types of products that you will see in any consumer economy in the world. So the fact that there is this one national system and that DOD wanted to start having the U.S. source supplies in Central Asia, it was very natural for them to turn to us and important for us to respond positively because that is our responsibility under the national supply system. That's our stuff. So that's really why it was important that we respond. Now, the second part of this is how did we get to the services contract with TWI? Let me tell you just a little bit more about GSA. And GSA, of course, does many things as other than supplies. We take care of buildings, telephones, motor vehicle fleets for the United States government, et cetera. But the supply operation that I work with is about a $1.4 billion annual transaction volume that's going to federal agencies worldwide. And in this system that we have, we are largely based and focused on United States operations. We have three primary acquisition centers, New York, Fort Worth, and Kansas City, and we know how to buy stuff here. But we don't know how to buy stuff outside of the United States very much. And we certainly didn't know how to buy things in Central Asia. So what we were really looking for as we started talking about what we needed to do to help DOD is we really needed what equated to a fourth acquisition center. So we put together a statement of work for a services contract that would engage some entity that could match our organization. We have buyers, we have transportation people, we have product engineers, that sort of thing. And in our system, requisitions, orders, if you will, are coming through this national supply system daily, worldwide, which we are filling either from warehouses here or ordering from vendors. And we reprogram the computers so that with the services contract, we would identify high demand items to whoever was going to win this thing to go out and find those products in Central Asia. And as we started getting products approved, these are competitively sourced products, then as these requisitions came in every night from Afghanistan, we'd simply flip them off and put them in a bucket and then pass them on to whoever was going to win the services contract. And it was going to be their responsibility to establish the source, to present to us the product descriptions. Our engineers would review those, make sure it worked, get all the electronics working so that we could give them an order. They could place the order and then manage the supply chain on into Afghanistan. So that's the long and short answer of why it was important and how we took the first steps. We were first contacted in 2009. The contract with TWI is in March of 2010. And during that period, we were frankly in a steep learning process. How should we do this? You know, what's over there? Got an awful lot of help from Defense Logistics Agency, United States Transportation Command, U.S. Central Command. There was a small team in GSA, I'd say probably less than a dozen people that are sprinkled Washington, Chicago, the acquisition centers, Fort Worth turned out to be our contracting office, where we got all the logistics relationships set up, computer reprogrammed, and then from that point it was waiting to see who was going to win the service contract. We did a couple of spot buys, bought some toilet tissue, Uzbekistan, and rebar from Georgia. We can really do this, and then set back and have the contract ready to go. So that brings us up with establishing a little bit of the history of who we are and what happened up to the point of March 2010. Enter TWI. So back to you.
That's a very exciting way to talk about it. I remember when I was first learning about this, thinking, like, do we seriously ship toilet paper from America to Afghanistan? Like, that seems very logical that we would be able to not do that.
I'm not an acquisition person, so I'll not try to recite all the acquisition laws, but we are focused by acquisition law to actually source from the United States. There's all sort, you know, Trade Agreement Act, other things. And we also have some very special vendor sources here. The Ability One, which has the factories that are worked in by the folks who are blind or handicapped, that sort of thing. I guess maybe 30% of our cube coming through the warehouses are from those folks. So actually within 30 days of hearing the request that we were going to need to do that, do this, we actually got on the phone with them and said, look, this is coming. This is important. We're going to keep you apprised as we go along. We are focused on the United States. We are very much interested in this new model. It will help us, we think, in future settings that are similar.
Great. Well, then enter TWI. Let me ask, maybe Jake, you can talk a little bit about who you are, and you're an old company that's been doing logistics for a long time, and explain a little bit about your thinking and your framework as you came into this process, and maybe talk a little bit about how you identified the products that you thought were most workable and kind of figured out that list of things that you could do and how to do it.
Okay.
Is that right for you?
Yeah, it's good. So first of all, thanks for having us here. Thank you, GSA, for being here with us and for everybody taking time out of your day to come listen a little bit about the program that we put together. For TWI, our core competency, our focus, our expertise, we built it around doing customized supply chains for customers that operate in difficult environments. Traditionally, going back in history, TWI is an old company, 168-year-old company that was originally founded to manage the export of coffee beans from Brazil into Northern Europe in 1844. And if you can imagine how difficult it would have been in 1844 to ship coffee beans across the Atlantic Ocean and import them into Europe. So it's always been built on managing these kind of unique expeditionary supply chains. And so through the years, kind of back to our original legacy, we've been involved in customizing supply chains to support customers that are operating in challenging environments. Our more contemporary history is focused around starting in 1998, TWI was awarded the first of its kind overseas food prime vendor program when DLA started the concept of outsourcing the management of its commodities by commercial partners. TWI was awarded the first overseas food prime vendor program for Germany, for Northern Europe, and we've been managing that program now for 14 years, and it also was modified in 2003 to include Central Asia. So we've been operating supply chains into Central Asia since 2003. When we saw you see these bid boards, and frankly, we don't look at the bid boards very often. When we saw this, the solicitation, the scope of work, it really resonated within our team, and we thought, this is clearly something we can do. We've built our people and our technology around kind of going into new markets, doing local sourcing, setting up consolidation, distribution operations. So for us, I think we understood pretty well from day one what GSA was trying to accomplish with this. There were some explicit tasks in the solicitation in the pre-proposal conference that were pretty simple. They wanted to shorten the supply chain, have quicker deliveries to their customers. So buying closer to the customers would give you quicker deliveries. And then inherent in that would be to reduce transportation costs. And I think if you look at the track record and hear the voice of the customer, we've been able to accomplish both of those. Simultaneously, we've been able to also find product at prices that are often lower than the acquisition cost of the product, even here in the U.S., including all the volume that GSA has with their U.S. suppliers. So we were able to also get the product at a competitive price. And I think the whole time what has been helpful is understanding what we call back in the Army, the commander's intent, understanding what the big picture is of what GSA was trying to accomplish in terms of the mandate from DOD. Because of our relationships with DLA as a prime vendor, kind of understanding what the market is trying to do, we knew the commander's intent was to accelerate spend in Central Asia to support what was at the time the northern GLOC, and it transformed into the NDN. So so we kind of been involved in that initiative with the NDN. We've been shipping across into Central Asia, running cold chain from Germany into Uzbekistan and into Kyrgyzstan. So we have experience with that. And we were involved in the original test shipments at the end of 2008 to reestablish the NDN or the NGLOC at the time, working test shipments with CENTCOM and with TRANSCOM through our DLA contract. So we understood the commander's of intent of what GSA was trying to accomplish. So I think we've been try to stay dialed in on what the explicit tasks are in the program, and also help contribute to the bigger goals of GSA and DOD and the U.S. government.
And Boban, you want to add to that?
Yeah. Like Jake pointed out earlier, we specialize, our core competency is integrating different supply chains in difficult environments. And as we were putting our execution plan for this contract, we decided that we have to take a very hands-on approach, and that hands-on approach really involved three different stages, if I can call it like that. First was performing very proactive planning, mission-oriented planning that involves utilizing our business intelligence tools to analyze the historical demand data that GSA had from the previous years. The second very important element in our approach was to ensure that we're going to get the most competitive pricing, and we're going to do that in a transparent and FAR compliant manner. So by analyzing the historical demand data, we were able to recognize where are those commodity groups and what is the annual spend for different items that we are going to source that will enable our procurement specialists to sit down and perform very trivial negotiations with the suppliers in order to obtain that competitive prices that we are looking at. And the third important element was to assure that we're going to meet deliveries to the client. In order to do that, we recognize that it's very important that we tapped into the existing networks of different 3PLs operating in that area. And very, very early in the program, we pointed out to GSA, which was very collaborative and took our recommendation into account, to consider establishing different consolidation points in the area where you can consolidate material, maximize the load in a transportation assets, and achieve the overall best value for the end user. So that's a little bit about the approach we took towards executing and starting up this program.
Okay, can you talk a little bit more deeply about how you identified the products and how did you actually, you have a database of what, 60,000 suppliers? Something like that? Several thousand suppliers.
Joel, you all.
How did you find them? How did you get them to where they needed to be? Talk a little more about that, if you would.
I'll talk about, at least on the initial end for GSA, how, you know, in this solicitation, we'd included a list of roughly 100 products that we thought there might be some success being able to find those in Central Asia. And the way we did that was, first, we looked at kind of the sales data, you know, what customers in Afghanistan, the U.S. military and some of the contractors are right now ordering from GSA, and Ken kind of elaborated on what those product commodities are. So we kept that list of 100 items. You know, we looked at the top selling items. We wanted to be able to establish a certain high volume initially to be able to engage potential suppliers in Central Asia, to get them interested, build enough business volume to kind of capture their attention with this, to give them incentive to participate. So we took the list of top items, and then we kind of screened it for items, again, that we think would be readily available. The Defense Logistics Agency as well as the U.S. Central Command had performed some initial market surveys, and TWI actually helped the Defense Logistics Agency with their market surveys, just to get a broad range of here's what the markets in Central Asia look like, here's some of the things they manufacture, here's some strengths, some things we might be able to find there. In addition, the GSA team internally had been doing some basically, you know, just internet research. There are a couple, frankly, some kind of Target or Walmart equivalents in Central Asia that have websites and sell, you know, to consumers in Central Asia. There's an Uzbek and a Kazakh, a couple websites, and I went through there and said, oh, well, you know, these cleaners are available in the commercial market. And so I said, you know, these would be good targets. So that's how we assembled the initial list. And, you know, over the past, you know, and that was in 2010 when that started rolling, and we've found nearly all of those items in Central Asia and are currently purchasing it, and actually we can distribute these around. We have a catalog with about 140 items right now that we've you know, that we have found in the region using this model. But the more interesting part is that over time our customers in Afghanistan, the people that are actually using these products, you know, running the bases, cleaning the dining facilities, et cetera, doing construction in Afghanistan, they came to us and said, you know, we're buying X, Y, and Z. Can you find this for us in Central Asia? Because as Ken had mentioned, you know, GSA's focus in this is supply chain efficiencies, supply chain, you know, thinning out the supply chain, getting things to the people that need it faster, more effectively, cheaper if possible. And this supply chain, being that it's much closer, originates much closer to the customers, the things that they need get there a lot faster, and time is everything in Afghanistan right now. So they're coming to us saying, can you buy this for us in Central Asia, which kind of is testament that the product we're finding are good products. They're, you know, equivalent to what we would buy in the U.S. or elsewhere. We're getting them there faster. They want this. So we're reacting now as much, you know, to our own internal sales data, to customer requests saying, buy this, get this in Central Asia for us. And then in addition, when TWI is out in the market in Central Asia, you know, in Kyrgyzstan, in Kazakhstan, in Tajikistan, and they run across a vendor that makes, you know, paper towels or makes, you know, tablecloth or something that we haven't currently asked them to find, they'll bring that to our attention and say, we think this is a good fit for your program. We think you can create a market for this product if you add it. And so we're also doing a lot more of that now.
Joel, shall we pass?
Yeah, what
we're doing. We're going to just let these start circulating. Don't keep it. Just flip through, get an idea of the pages. And
Infobot, yes. You wanted to add something?
Yeah, just wanted to add a couple of more things in what Joel previously said. The original list that Joel mentioned, 112 items, was part of the original solicitation that GSA published in 2009. As part of the preparation for our proposal preparation, we started doing some initial market research, and at that time we recognized and realized that the region itself is capable to produce or to source those items in most of the cases. 2.5 years into the program, I can proudly say that in 2010 we were able to source 98% of the items that were in that original list. Out of these 98%, 92 items were approved by GSA, both commercially and technically. So that's a really a great news story, I will say.
I would also say that you know, we continue to participate in and have been very active in these kind of interagency visits into the region. We call them road shows, but where we go in with DLA and GSA and the different government agencies and have forums where we invite suppliers in. On our own volition, we also do supplier training events where we're bringing in suppliers and teaching them how to get onto the program and educating them on the process and the specifications and the qualification process. In our main operations center in Dubai, we have a whole floor of Russian-speaking staff that we've recruited, procurement professionals that have a lot of them Western education, but they're from the market, so they know the market. And we also have, you know, offices on the ground in Central Asia where we have local staff. So we spent a lot of time with some of the government agencies like COSNEX in Kazakhstan, which is an agency that's established to promote the export of products from Kazakhstan. And so they're very much engaged with the manufacturing base, which is our target. So we're very much engaged with our local partners and the local governments to work with them to bring new suppliers onto the program. And we've had a lot of success with that.
So you actually then have partners, some government partners on the ground, because I was going to ask you to talk a little bit more about how do you actually go out and find the different companies or the small businesses who can supply this? And, you know, it sounds like you have a lot of different ways that you end up being led to them, but maybe talk just a little bit more about how you've assembled all of this set of suppliers.
Again, as part of the execution plan that we put together, we realized way back in the day that in order for us to be successful in this program, we have to have the right resources in place. And those are the people that needs to have experience doing business in the local market, that understand the cultural norms, that are, again, Western educated. And that proactive planning starts all the way from doing the proper recruitment and staffing plan. In terms of how we do it, after we assemble the team, again, we recognize that we're going to have a local presence. Our procurement is centralized in Dubai, but on top of that, we have a local representatives in Uzbekistan, in Kazakhstan, in Kyrgyzstan, and those are representatives that do a day-to-day discussion with suppliers. They perform market research. They collaborate with entities like CASNEX, or in Uzbekistan is UZ Build. Those are the people that develop relationship with the American Chamber of Commerce on the ground. And again, those are the people that perform due diligence on suppliers, because the program cannot be successful if we end up choosing wrong suppliers. The due diligence process was essential part into properly standing up the program, and procurement is centralized in Dubai in our case, but having the local representation on the ground it's the most important thing to guarantee the success of the program.
Since you mentioned due diligence, can you talk a little bit about the due diligence process that you've had to undertake?
The due diligence on our part starts from doing a market research, firstly identifying the companies, doing the site visits, performing assessment on their system capabilities, on their production capabilities. Our quality control manager often goes to the resources and talk to the owners, talk to the employees, understand their background. And the second stage, when we get into sourcing and pricing discussion, we ensure that the product they're offering is in line with what GSA technical specifications are referring to before we actually pass that package to GSA for further review and approval.
Yeah, and then on GSA side, you know, we had specified up front in our contractual documents, you know, the types of due diligence that we expect from TWI. When they present a product to GSA, it's a proposed product that includes all the contractual terms of, you know, price and quality standards, delivery. But there's also a company profile in it that gives us some background on who the supplier is to give us some basis for deciding whether we think this will be a reliable partner or not going forward, because, you know, our model is based on repetitive ordering. These aren't one-time buys. We establish kind of term contracts with these companies, and we, you know, intend to work with them over a given amount of time and, you know, have them fill multiple orders on a repeating basis. So we have to make sure up front that we're doing business through TWI with reputable, reliable companies. So what we do when GSA, when we receive these packages, we have, you know, I take these the product and the specifications to our engineers. They then compare them against the U.S. specifications. You know, we have a full range of specifications for everything we buy, some of them commercial, some of them government specific, and we'll get into all that. But, you know, we know what we typically buy, and we compare the Central Asian product against it. And actually, that was one of the risk factors we identified going in. We had, you know, our experience in Tajikistan and Kazakhstan, which is, you know, pretty thin going into this, so we didn't know what to expect in terms of product quality, both from, you know, how strong things are, all the way up to, you know, how safe things are. You know, their manufacturing processes are differently. They document their their process is just, it's a very different atmosphere and manufacturing regime in that part of the world. So we really didn't know what to expect. And frankly, we've been extremely, you know, pleasantly surprised at what we've been able to find. As you know, I said we're up to 140 items that we've been able to approve as equivalent to U.S. specification. And we do allow for some variance. For instance, in terms of I'd say the Russian old Russian manufacturing standards, the Ghost regime, and we can do kind of crosswalks between that and the ASTM and various other U.S. standards that do allow for us to kind of compare them and determine equivalence. But there are other times where the standards don't exist, so our engineers physically will take either a sample or the product cut sheets that TWI can provide and are able to approve them yes or no versus those. So that was one major risk factor we had identified was quality and have been, you know, like I said, pleasantly surprised with that. The other real issue that we had identified was company capacity. And we weren't sure if we would find companies that A, could make enough of what we wanted, but B, whether they would have kind of the financial and institutional heft to maintain a relationship to be able to, you know, be reliable in our supply chain. And that's where TWI's on-the-ground judgment has been very valuable. They have people that physically go out and can inspect these companies. In addition, we liaise with the host nation governments and get kind of intelligence and feedback from the host nation governments, from their chambers of commerce or COSNEX, these quasi-governmental kind of organizations that promote business atmosphere in each of these countries. And so that's been very valuable and very helpful in certain countries to make sure that the companies we're working with are reputable and can meet what we need.
So let me just clarify, one clarification and then one further question. You didn't offer preferential price support or financing or anything to any of the companies. They just were existing companies that could operate as sort of a clarification. But the second point is, did you have leeway in terms of looking at some of the process issues around supply to the U.S. government in terms of, I don't know, OSHA regulations or some of the different things that American businesses really have to sign up to? I'm curious if you could just clarify on both those accounts.
They typically know, you know, what to expect. They know that we demand transparency. We want to see, you know, full and open pricing. Competition is a big, you know, a big thing, obviously. When you go into Central Asia, that's not necessarily the norm there. And so we kind of understood that going in and didn't know exactly how these companies would react to that. And again, have been very, and we, in the contract, we required TWI to compete everything. We want to see the records of the competition. We want to see the prices you receive for everything. We want to see full transparency of the acquisition process and the entire supply chain process. And again, I'll let TWI describe the specific results from some of the companies. But generally speaking, we've been able to kind of impart or help them understand this is how we do business and have been able to engage them using Western business practices. So, again, I think we've been fairly successful there through our services with TWI. In terms of leeway on some of the government regulations, Ken had referenced trade agreement acts, and so there's a full suite of procurement policies, procurement regulations that we as a U.S. government agency have to follow, and through this specific initiative to purchase products in Central Asia and also the South Caucasus originally in support of the Northern Distribution Network, in support of our U.S. forces in Afghanistan, the Department of Defense had actually assembled and got through Congress and various other, you know, regulatory bodies a suite of policy waivers, policy flexibilities to allow both GSA and the other U.S. government agencies that are doing this in Central Asia to give us a little bit of flexibility. Now, within GSA, again, we're typically interested in you know, making sure we have a competitive price And what we expect, what we look at in that is both the price of the product as well as what it costs to transport from Central Asia into Afghanistan. We'll compare that against what it would cost to transport from New Jersey into Afghanistan. So we have some flexibility in how we look at pricing. And in terms of technical quality is really the other thing we pay attention to. Again, we have some very specific standards that we have to meet to ensure that the safety of these of the products we buy is met, and but we do allow for some variance for different regional standards, different regional capacity, but at bottom line we always make sure what we're buying is safe for the people that are using it and will meet the intended function.
I want to turn now to talk a little bit about the development impact and the reason we're having this conversation. But first, I want to ask, do you want to explain the graphic that is on the screen? Anybody want to walk the group through this?
This is just basically an overview of how our model works, and Ken had described it quite a bit. But again, it's all in support of U.S. forces in Afghanistan, and they are the ultimate customer for everything we're buying. They're the originator of the orders and the end destination for these orders. They submit their orders electronically through what's called mil-strip requisitioning, which is basically an old legacy mainframe to mainframe ordering system that is wonderfully stable and wonderfully powerful, kind of first e-commerce system probably in the world, but works well, just can't change it, don't touch it. So we receive these orders from Afghanistan. And as Ken had mentioned, we have a catalog of 140 items. Or in our system, we have kind of equivalent items stood up where customer orders this, what we call an NSN, national stock number, for a certain product, and they expect to receive, it's a certain flatware cup or something. If we have that product sourced in Central Asia, we do a conversion, whether it's a different product, different quantity, different packaging. We then ship those orders off to TWI for them to fill for us using Central Asia vendors. So TWI would then issue a purchase order based on the pre-negotiated terms and conditions that we've set up with TWI. They then would send out purchase orders to our approved, to the approved sources, the sources that GSA has approved, at the terms and conditions that we have approved, to then have delivery of those products arranged for and made into Afghanistan. Now, TWI can talk a little bit more about, I'll let kind of Boban and Jake talk a little bit more about the specifics on that product. But again, once GSA hands its purchase order off, the key for GSA is, until it reaches the customer in Afghanistan, TWI is our supply chain integrator, our supply chain manager for the entire rest of this cycle. So Boban, is there anything you want to add to that?
I just want to point out that this piece here is fully automated. There is an EDI environment between GSA systems and TWA system that eliminates, first of all, automate the whole purchase order process and eliminates any possibility for human error. It's a matter of a couple of clicks until we have the purchase order ready to go to our pre-approved suppliers and can be anywhere in Central Asia, in Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, or Georgia. So after the purchase order is issued to the supplier, supplier puts their process in place, procurement process in place, and provide us the date when order can be picked up by our service providers, or 3PLs as we call them. In the case of Kazakhstan, we have a distribution or consolidation facility in Almaty where most of all of our suppliers in Kazakhstan will deliver to that distribution and consolidation facility for us to maximize the load, to maximize the space in the assets, and efficiently deliver the product to the warfighters in Afghanistan. In case of other countries in Central Asia, Uzbekistan or Georgia, we don't have a consolidation point in place, but we, as we call it, we consolidate on the fly. The orders are pretty decent size, where you can have a full truckload of dinnerware items, where we can dispatch a truck to go and collect material from a source in Georgia, and again we monitor the utilization of that asset, The way we execute this mission is multimodal transportation. There is a specific commodities that we push.
To give you an idea of scope, last fiscal year, we did 15,000 orders, 15,000 unique purchase orders through this model, utilizing, it's 140 products, and I want to say it's like 38 different suppliers spread around Central Asia and plus Georgia. So there's quite a bit of volume being pumped through this, and you can imagine quite a bit of logistics juggling that TWI is doing. In a fairly, you know, kind of austere environment that we weren't sure exactly how it was going to work when we got into this.
Just for some of you to be able to visualize this, the volume of these orders, just want to share with you a couple of stats that so far we moved close to 18,000 pallets, over 900 trucks. In terms of air freight shipments, we've executed over 25 million cubic feet of cargo, so it's pretty substantial program. And in terms of spend, up to this point, we think we are closely approaching $55 million from the inception of the program, which is remarkable.
I think one other, I don't know if it's clear, but the way the program is set up, it's a service-based program. So the product doesn't have any margin on it. The freight doesn't have any margin on it. All that's managed transparently at cost. And so that's part of our requirement, is to show GSA the competitive process. They understand the actual cost of the product, and they're not paying any margin or markup on the product or on the freight. We manage that process through a service fee. So that's the structure, and that's different than a lot of the more traditional ways of doing the procurement, more of a bidding process, and you know, you add some margin to cover your overhead. I think it's much more transparent, and you know, we're out looking for the best deal for GSA.
Well, this is really interesting, because you're talking about a transparent process, you're talking about high quality, you're talking about standards, you're talking about something that I think people feel comfortable being involved in and would feel comfortable wherever it happened. I want to turn those points to sort of a broader question in terms of potential development impact. I think as we think about local sourcing and purchasing in country in a lot of areas, you get to the point, well, toilet paper and paper towels and copier paper is not very sexy. We want to do big things. We want to have, you know, people working on oil rigs, or we want to have people actually building stuff. Sometimes the capacity isn't there. So I think it's helpful to think about areas where you can actually start, where people may have some existing infrastructure or have some existing products, and start building those up and using them as building blocks, which in it sounds like Central Asia has some capacity, both in terms of the government and then in terms of existing manufacturing processes that some other countries are not going to have. And Michael, I know you'll speak to this in a minute. But I want to ask if you can just, all of you, talk a little bit about how you, did you have to do capacity building for some of these suppliers? Did you have, and you talked a little bit about training, maybe in terms of both of bidding, but also getting up to standards. And then reflect from there on how you think efforts like this could have a longer term impact on human capital and on just sort of basic business operations. You mentioned Western management practices, which is an under-recognized but high-value impact that you would have. I want you to just reflect on some of those capacity building and longer-term impacts that you might have.
Maybe I'll start out a little bit. Understanding that, you know, there is kind of a sunset horizon to our activity here, you know, our goal was going into this was to utilize existing capacity, existing businesses, existing products to the extent possible, so we're not distorting the economies, so that, you know, when we leave, there's a vacuum when our purchasing goes somewhere else. So we're very cognizant of that. So we try to identify items that are commercially available already before we ask for them. That being said, there are things we need and there are things that we want to buy that aren't currently available exactly up to specification for what we're looking for in Central Asia. And I'll use an example of one I like to tell, and that is it's copy paper. In 2010, when we had done kind of our first tour through the region, doing different vendor conferences to explain to the vendor communities in these countries, you know, we want to buy from you, here's what we're looking to buy, and here's how you go about engaging in our particular model. We did that in conjunction with the U.S. Transportation Command, Defense Logistics Agency, and some other DOD entities. So we were in Tbilisi, Georgia, and we'd heard about this wonderful copy paper factory, and Ken has a sample of the copy paper here. But they told us that this copy paper factory was located in an IDP settlement, an internally displaced person settlement, from people that had been displaced during Georgia's conflict with Russia. And so the Georgian government had built this settlement to house these people until hopefully eventually they can return to their homes up in the north of Georgia. So we said we'd be interested. We want to buy copy paper. Let's go take a look at the place. We went to the factory. It's a wonderful little factory. Met the owner of the factory and the people that ran it. And again, they're employing IDP labor here at the settlement. So we took Ken actually lugged a case of this paper back home to the States when we returned, so we could have it tested to see is this good enough for us to buy. So we had it tested versus U.S. spec and found that the paper itself is wonderful stuff. It just didn't quite measure up to what we were looking for. So, you know, the smoothness, I guess, with copy paper, if it's the smoothness is different from one side to the other, that's where you start getting jams because it affects the speed at which it goes through the printer. The brightness was a little bit different from what they like to have, I guess, in Georgia, a blue tint to their paper, and we like white paper. The sizing was different. They have metric sizing. Their packaging was a little bit different. And so after we had it tested and had these results back, we actually convened a series of conference calls with GSA's paper engineers out of New York. We don't speak Georgian, nor do we speak Russian. Actually, one of our paper engineers did speak Russian, fortunately, but generally we don't speak Russian. We had TWI on the phone who could do some translation and as kind of holders of the contracts, they help facilitate this process. And then the paper plant and their experts, they're process experts. And we explained to them, we had provided to them our test results and said, here are the areas where we found that it's a little bit below our standards and would like for you to work to make a slightly different product than what so we can buy it. We explained to them about smoothness, what our test methods are, and how to improve that manufacturing, and various other elements I talked about. So they went, through our efforts with TWI and the plant, they went back, re-engineered their process slightly, and were able to send us a new sample that we had tested and met everything we had looked for. And so that was an example of a small example of capacity building where we explained to them that, the U.S. standard, the Western standard for this particular product is a little bit different than what they would produce for their domestic market. They were able to meet that at kind of minimal cost. And now we're buying copy paper from, halfway around the world, Tbilisi, Georgia, being produced by, internally displaced people in this camp. So
let me add a couple of things. When we first started the project, we truly were trying to read widely. We knew nothing about this area. And one of the first things that we read raised the concern of the capacity that we might think we're doing a great job of buying lots of paper towels or something from an area when, in fact, we might be distorting what's going on in the local economy. Now, we're logisticians. We're not international commercial experts. But with that idea in mind, one of the first things we did writing the requirements for the computer changes that were going to happen in our system was to build in switches so that we could set percentages or quantities or minimum size, maximum size orders to give us some tools that we knew we would need later on, knowing that one company could never produce everything that we needed, so that we could start accessing that capability to start doing some rotational things among vendors. We were certainly conscious of the capacity aspect. The other maybe related comment is at the beginning of this, our our early learning and experiences was almost totally facilitated through the DoD partners. And it was only a little later into the exercise that we started getting exposed to what USAID and State Department and European Bank of Redevelopment, what those folks were doing. And so the occasional tours through Central Asia provided a little bit of an opportunity for government-to-government kinds of networking. And I think we've had a couple of instances where our vendors have been plugged into one of those helping agencies. And again, this is really very early. I mean, this is only a couple of years into this kind of model. I think that's somewhat related to a little bit of what you were asking about, capacity and impact on local development.
Yeah, and I think I just asked one final question. You touched on it a little bit. Was just where do you think you will see the next couple of years? Will some of these companies be able to gradually move into selling to other large international markets or within regional markets?
There's some specific things we've been working on. There's a lot of Western companies moving in the market. It's, you know, Central Asia is practically a. It's an exciting market. There's natural resources there. It is along this modern Silk Road that you see currently being built. There's Western fast-moving consumer good retailers coming in, a lot of retailers coming in, particularly around in Kazakhstan. And we started kind of a buying cooperative with one of these major FMCGs where, you know, maybe they're buying plastic bags in China or Russia and bringing them into the Kazakh market, and we're showing them that we have actually Western standard products, suppliers that we've identified, we've taken through the vetting process that could very likely meet their standards. So they're starting to buy or look at buying from our supplier base, which I think gives life after whatever the DoD or whatever the GSA decides to do in the market. If you think about it in terms of local content outside of government, you think in terms of the energy sector there, particularly in Kazakhstan, where there's a lot of pressure on local content. We see also the ability to turn some of these suppliers to these out in Western Kazakhstan, where the oil fields are. They got the high quality products, they got the right price points, and so you know, we see opportunities for our supplier base to continue to develop. When you're there on the ground in Kazakhstan, you're in Shymkent or you're in Almaty, and you see they're literally building the road that transits across Kazakhstan that will be connecting China with Russia and Central Asia, and these suppliers are located along this east-west trade corridor, and they're going to have access to distribution capabilities. So I think there's certainly life after the program for our supplier base.
That's great. That's good.
Yeah, I just want to add a couple of other things in addition to what Jake pointed out. In addition to building the capacity of those manufacturers in Central Asia, what's very, very important, and people usually don't think about it, we are building unique expertise with those suppliers. For example, when we first started operating under this program, we realized that not many companies know how to do export. They had no reason to do export in the past. Now we have 40 plus suppliers that understand their export regulation. They are building their internal company capabilities to be able to do it, to do export, to do business on a Western standard. So it's not only building a capacity, but also building the internal expertise to perform business on an international scale.
Yeah, and I think that's an area of capacity building that goes widely unrecognized but is extremely valuable. Are folks from GSA want to respond to that, or should we open to questions?
I was going to say that is probably okay. The biggest lead by.
But, you know, long term, it's the skill building. It's being exposed to Western ways of doing business, transparency, competition, best price, as well as the mechanics of how to take a product, build it to you know, a high quality standard, and then move it around the world, whether, you know, outside of their domestic market, are valuable leave behinds. And again, GSA, our primary mission is supply chain efficiencies, supply chain support. But, you know, we're proud to have been able to contribute to the U.S. government objectives in building some of that capacity in this region.
The only thing I would add is that GSA is one of the owners of the supply chain. We have a little bit of a responsibility here to be watching how events are managed over there. And if there should develop over the next few years mechanisms that, you know, perhaps U.S.-funded purchasing is going on in a way that our particular logistics arrangements don't currently are set up for now, we just need to watch for those opportunities. Foreign military sales is an old program that where U.S. dollars are purchasing and furnishing, you know, foreign governments with tools and so forth. And maybe there will be an applicability here. That's not GSA's responsibility to set all that up, but as logistics partners, if we see that coming, we can play a role. So I would say we're simply watchful, and we want to just continue to support the overall goals as much as we can.
Well, thanks. I want to thank you all and open to a couple questions I'm going to ask. I know we've got a couple people who have particular points, and then folks around the room. Michael Levitt, you have spent a lot of time working with capacity building for some of these suppliers and small companies trying to, you know, produce for larger U.S. entities. Can you just make a couple comments?
Well, first, I think this is terrific. Both on a personal basis, having started in business in Central Asia in 1986, finding Western quality toilet paper is just a major step forward. Again, personal basis. And secondly, when the shooting stopped in Kosovo, we were commissioned, my old organization, CDC Development Solutions, to build supply chain with the seven frontline states. And we found the product, we just didn't have willing American buyers. On the ground in Kosovo. So this is, I think, a major step forward. A couple of things come to mind. I heard USAID mentioned once. USAID paid us a huge amount of money to work in these countries, starting in 1994 to build local capacity. And we were little guys. They put in, I don't know, $300 million, $400 million in building SME capacity. When I talked to TWI a year ago, no one had talked to AID about the companies that we all had worked for. Did we waste our time? I mean, it seems to me there's a major coordination effort. Either we did a good job building local capacity or we wasted the time. But we had Americans in hundreds, if not thousands, of businesses building up their capacity to compete in a potentially Western market. So I'm just wondering, whatever happened to USAID in all of this? And second, on this local capacity building, local content, local ownership really matters. Does ownership matter to you all in selecting suppliers? Because there's lots of different owners in these countries. And I realize you work to avoid the anti-terrorism provisions of who you do business with. But other than that, given that this can have huge stability operations, obviously purchasing within Afghanistan is considered now counterinsurgency programming. This is capacity building, but it's also conflict prevention and stability operations. Does that come into play when you select suppliers? Who owns the company? So those are the two parts.
And let me also, since you're talking about stability, Dr. Lamb, I know you've worked in this region a lot, too. I want to just ask for your comments as well.
Great. Thanks so much. I'm Robert Lamb. I'm director of the Program on Crisis, Conflict, and Cooperation here at CSIS. We've done a good deal of work on development governance in Afghanistan and Pakistan and other fragile environments. And, you know, looking at the issues of private sector development in fragile states, you know, you look at government solutions, you look at private sector solutions. And we've been trying to see sort of, you know, where do the two actually interact? I just have a couple of questions that I'd like to ask you along those lines. First of all, you make this whole process seem like it's about as easy as planning a high school reunion. You need paper plates, no problem. You need a yurt, you're welcome. There must have been some really bad days along the way, some challenges to overcome. Could you talk about those a little bit? Because this seems to me, you know, maybe these particular set of countries, there was already some markets in place and some capacity that already existed to build on. But I imagine a lot of other places that capacity might be a little bit more challenging. In addition to the bad days question, were there any U.S. policies in place or any U.S. institutions, laws, organizations that kind of stood in your way, or if there were some sort of a policy change that would be useful to facilitate this kind of development, what would that be? Thanks very much.
We'd like to start.
Okay.
Ken, you want to take
A couple things, and I'll go down the list, and then we can hit them back and forth. The ownership question, and I'll quickly defer to Joel, but where our priority is on manufacturers, and then under that would be distributors. But I don't think we take ownership other than just the vetting in any.
Right. Ken has described, we have an order of precedence in terms of the types of companies we try to work with. Items that are manufactured in one of these subject companies or countries as having them ideally the most economic impact. Items that are assembled, you know, bring in a bunch of different parts and put together, and then lastly, distributors that are products manufactured elsewhere that are sold by companies that are legitimately established in the Central Asian nations. So in terms of the actual owners and kind of who controls the entities, TWI does that due diligence for us and does include that in the company profiles. We do our own internal due diligence looking at U.S. government databases. Treasury operates one, GSA operates one that says, you know, here's some bad actors you got to stay away from. We also have there's a vetting cell within U.S. Central Command that also looks out for the bad guys. So we run those, both our product and our transportation suppliers, through that vetting process to make sure we're not funding the bad guys unintentionally.
Sorry, could you specify what kinds of bad guys? Just terrorists or local warlords who are abusing citizens that we don't know about?
Again, the GSA database itself is, or companies that have been debarred for, and I'm not an expert on exactly all the reasons they're debarred, but they're debarred vendors. The U.S. government entities are prohibited from doing business with. The Treasury, and I saw a couple Treasury, I thought I saw someone from Treasury here. Maybe they could help. There's the specially designated list, and that one is, again, I'm not certain exactly how bad guys are defined and how deep it goes and how, you know, far into the local political culture it gets into, but we check against that list. TWI also does their due diligence, and actually another resource we have is with the host nation governments. We talk to the government of Kazakhstan and say, give us a list of vendors that you think would be good partners in this effort for us. So again, you know, that's not our sole measure of reliability, but it's something we do take into account. And we ask them, if there's something we need to know about some of these vendors we're working with, please let us know. So, and then also TWI, I'll let you talk about kind of what your process is on that.
Yeah, in terms of performing due diligence, we try to perform and do the background check on those suppliers by utilizing a few engine mechanisms that have been provided to us. But in terms of bad days question, I just want to make sure everybody understands the approval process all the way from market research, sourcing, pricing negotiation to technical and commercial approval by GSA can take up to several months because there is a very detailed process we have to go through. To answer your question about bad days, well, we have several phone calls where companies were not very happy to be part of this whole process that takes up to a few months, going back and forth. But at the end, they realize that those are the processes that they have to go through in order to be approved source and be on the catalog. And I don't know if I answered your question precisely, but.
In kind of a related point on obstacles, bad days, in Uzbekistan, the common kind of business practice is cash prepayment at time of order. And the U.S. government does not operate on cash prepayment before order. We pay you when we have the product or it's loaded on a truck that we control. Then we can pay for it legally. There's a fundamental disconnect there that it's not easy to surmount. So TWI had identified a kind of a quasi-governmental export credit insurance solution that has kind of bridged that gap. So it took a long time, for quite a while, and the Uzbek government was probably the loudest among all the Central Asian countries of, you know, why you said you were going to buy from us. Why don't I see $100 billion being spent, you know, each year in our country from the U.S. Department of Defense? So, you know, and that message, when it gets passed to the U.S. ambassador in Uzbekistan or whichever general happens to be meeting with these people, that rolls downhill to us and, you know, hey, you guys need to do a better job. So, but again, we found a solution. TWI found a solution to that that GSA could live with. And, you know, there's a cost to that we build into the price of our product that we purchase there. So we found that, you know, the business environment isn't an exact match to what we would typically like to see, but through some flexibility and creativity, we are able to get over a lot of that.
Great. And can you speak to the USAID question as well?
USAID, and just generally speaking, you know, GSA is by far not the lead agency in this whole effort. And there's an entire interagency council that was put together to help kind of administer and execute this U.S. policy. It's headed up by U.S. Central Command and the Defense Logistics Agency, but there's a full range of Department of Defense and civilian agencies, as well as some private companies that kind of participate in this interagency council. USAID is definitely a very important piece of that. There's others who kind of work in the development area, such as the EBRD, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, is a valued partner in Central Asia on the ground, and the U.S. Treasury, you know, obviously funds a good amount of what they do. So we have access to and do use this network of experts in the field in Central Asia to advise us and help us and TWI find companies that they're familiar with, that we are actually working with, and most recently with the EBRD, there's a mattress manufacturer in Kyrgyzstan, a small woman-owned business that EBRD had kind of turned TWI onto, and has worked with to help, again, in the technical capacity to manufacture a mattress that won't go up in flames if you drop a cigarette on it, to work with some of the EBRD's known supply chain for chemical flame retardants to add that as an additive to the product so it'll meet U.S. spec. So it is our regular practice, and whenever we travel through Central Asia, we meet with USAID, whenever we go to the embassies, et cetera. Any specific companies that I'm familiar with that we've approved that kind of have accessed USAID programs, I'm not certain of.
Joanna, can I follow up? Yeah. I'm just wondering if trying to get a development twofer out of this would put an impossible burden on you all, because there's a lot of Russian-owned companies you can do business with there that does nothing for the people of Turkmenistan or Uzbekistan. And would putting a local content bonus, benefit, whatever, on this, would that make TWI's work unbearable? Is it a doable proposition? Because we're spending American dollars, I'd like to get as much out of it as we possibly can. And I would only say in the future, I think a lot of the organizations that did business development for under AID grants probably do know companies that could have been beneficial and would have helped jumpstart some of this activity. Not all of them, but a lot of money was spent to build up local capacity, and I think it's a real waste if you don't take some advantage of it.
Well, to the extent that on manufacturing is our first priority, I would think that's, you know, partial, getting at what you're talking about. And the other, maybe we should talk more afterwards to get more of your ideas on that. But manufacturing is at least partially hitting that. I would say, too, that if there is distribution going on already of that item or like items with a company that's in there, I mean, we look at, in this country, we don't look at Walmart as a non-entity. They're a major employer, and so I would think that jobs are positively affected to some degree, regardless of ownership, just by having more volume flow through.
Yeah, I just want to add a little bit to that, Ken. I mean, recently we had a specific example where, I forgot the commodity, but it was one of those situations where we were able to find a manufacturer for certain item in one country and find a distributor for the same item in another country. Manufacturer was I think a little bit more expensive, but it was looked more favorably from the same aspect that you just pointed out. So in case-to-case basis, definitely that has been taken into consideration by the contracting people in GSA, I believe.
Great. Let me open up to some other questions. Bill Crowder, you had your hand up, and let me just sort of maybe take a couple at a time.
I'm just looking at some of the prices in here, and I'm amazed.
Could you just identify yourself real quick?
I'm Bill Crowder from LMI, Logistics Management Institute. I'm just amazed that the price differential on the HB products is so close to some of the stateside prices, and I just picked the 5500 printer, which is very comparable. So I'm really wondering how you're driving out the transportation component to keep the prices in that same relative thing, because most of those printers are made in Thailand or somewhere like that. I mean, they're most made in the Indian subcontinent region, because that's where the cost of manufacturing is best. So how are you driving, you're doing a great job, but how are you driving out the transportation component, because we all need to do better with that?
And then let's
am I missing something and you found a local source that really makes HP printers in that part of the world?
Great, and we'll take that one and then a question right here, if you could identify yourself.
Hi, I'm Grant Hogan from Centra Technology. I had a question actually regarding once you've there's the discussion of how you located the sort of proper place that they've all been vetted. I was actually wondering about sort of the security concerns that come up with switching from sort of U.S. sourced to locally sourced goods.
Well, I could say on the printer cartridges, Bill, it is a high demand item, and we got some substantial volumes we're negotiating with for that item. I don't know what they're doing with all the printer cartridges in Afghanistan, but they seem to like them. It's a PowerPoint war going on to some extent.
It's the printers too. I mean, right. It's a great price compared to where it is. You've done something.
Yeah, we are negotiating. We're negotiating distributors against each other. We work with authorized distributors. We create competition between the distributors, and for the transportation piece into Afghanistan, obviously we're managing that part. Mainly through consolidation and able to reduce the cost going into Afghanistan. So
the toner cartridges, every discussion we have, and Ken will attest to this, every discussion we have with the GSA supply chain, if toner cartridges are mentioned, it just skews all the results, because they're actually, given what we buy, napkins and toilet paper and office supplies, toner cartridges are fairly expensive items on an individual basis, and we do such a large volume of them. That being said, we get pretty good pricing because we do such a large volume, kind of aggregate demand for the U.S. government. So when we buy them in the U.S., we generally get a really good price. In Central Asia, there was quite a bit of, that was a lot of work getting that source put in place. We try to be, we're very careful about where we source things from, and if they're not manufactured in Central Asia, where they actually are manufactured. HP toner cartridges, they are manufactured where HP wants to manufacture them, and you really don't have a choice if you're buying original OEM parts, which these are actual HP toner cartridges. So TWI worked with quite a few number of potential suppliers in the region, and obviously ran a competition, but identified one in Kazakhstan. And Boban, if I stray from truth here, please yank me back. But they had identified one that had the best price, kind of the best delivery terms in Almaty, but the prices still weren't, for the majority of them, still weren't where we could approve them. They were still a little bit higher than we needed them to be. So they had kind of our anticipated demand in hand. It's not nothing is guaranteed. There's no guaranteed volume that we guarantee anybody when TWI signs a contract. But here's our spend for the year, and here's likely what you can kind of anticipate. So they were able to, that particular distributor was able to go back to HP and negotiate kind of better terms given the volume that they were anticipating to have. Being able to get it for a lot cheaper, as a Gold Star distributor or something to that effect, and they're able to achieve better tier of pricing, which eventually got down to very close to what we pay in the U.S. for them at a cost price. And actually what you're seeing here in the catalog is the price, the sell price, which is, you know, we obviously pay a lower price for the, you know, when we purchase them. So that one took a lot of work. And frankly, when we talk about distributors, the Kazakh government is very sensitive about when U.S. Central Command goes to them and says, here's what we spent in your country in support of the NDN, you know, keep allowing our trains to roll through with our products. They say, well, how much of that is manufactured here? Because we don't care about anything else that's, you know, bought, that's distributed from our, including the HP toner cartridges. And I would kind of counter that, you know, through the activity that the GSA supply chain is undertaking in their country, this particular company now gets better pricing for HP toner cartridges and can offer them to the general population of Kazakhstan at a better price than they were paying before. So our activity is kind of underwriting a better price for the general population there. So that's a small, you know, kind of sample of how distributors can actually improve, you know, however small, this a micro situation somewhere.
And I mentioned at the beginning, I think we've been able to accomplish the explicit goals of reducing the transportation cost and shortening the supply chain. I think more times than not, 60% of the products were actually getting lower product cost than the CONUS product cost for actually without the recovery fee on that, and 82% are within, an additional 22% are within 10% of the U.S. product cost. We're able to find competitively priced products in the market, which I think was something that, you know, we didn't really know how that was going to work out as the program developed. So we've had some success there.
And there's another, the other question was security for the, and again, that goes back to kind of our due diligence review. You know, going into this, there was a lot of what we buy are products that come into contact with food. And so there was definitely a safety concern with sabotage or just general kind of different manufacturing processes where certain chemical additives are used in the manufacturing process. So we had some internal sensitivities to product safety. And through our review process, we have went through a very long kind of process with TWI explaining to them kind of what our product safety standards are, how our engineers look at those things, what the U.S. Code of Federal Regulation says about products that come into contact with food that we will not compromise on. You know, if it's a different color, we'll accept that, or if it's a slightly different size. But if it comes into contact with food, certain chemicals can't be used, certain manufacturing processes can't be used, and we will not compromise on those. So, again, it was an education from us to TWI and from TWI to the vendors to be able to comply with the product safety standards. I sense that your question is more related to, in terms of security, exactly kind of what type of security you talk.
I was thinking of actually getting it from the just say you're loading it into the truck, mm-hmm. making sure that all these different supply routes are actually being able to make it to the bases.
And I'll let TWI handle that aspect.
Yeah, we, in terms of supplying to the end destination, again, like I mentioned earlier, we are using already existing network of 3PLs and their relationship with the asset companies that are basically delivering the products by going through the approved routes. Certain transportation methods require different transportation standards. For example, if the cargo is a U.S. military consignee, cannot be transported through Uzbekistan. Can only be transported through Uzbekistan if it's on a rail. Transportation method, but that requires a different transit permit. To answer your question specifically, we're utilizing the already developed network in that part of the world, and tapping into the existing 3PL services they can provide.
And the Defense Department is actually using basically the same network. They've set up contracts to move military, to move goods from Central Asia into Afghanistan as military consigned freight. And so they go out and have, you know, competition amongst basically the same set of providers that we're using on our contract. They're using that same kind of organic transportation network to move product into Afghanistan. So, but security is obviously an issue to the extent that we can. Again, we vet those companies. We vetted the companies that we're using. The U.S. Central Command is vetting the transportation companies they're using to ensure, to the extent we can, that we're using you know, companies that aren't harmful or would pose a security risk.
Great. Let me just go to another round of questions here. Let's take 1, 2, 3. Sir?
Grant Smith from the Central Asia Caucasus Institute. I would be interested in some statistics about how much is in dollar value is coming from each country, and also sort of to repeat the Kazakh government question, how much of that is assembly and how much of that, I don't mean assembly, how much of that is distribution and how much of that is manufacturing or assembly. And I'm asking the latter question because I wonder if those HP toner cartridges are skewing the total dramatically.
I can answer that one quickly. Yeah, the answer is yes on that one.
Let's just take the other two questions and then answer them at once.
Thanks. I'm Clint Doggett. I'm from the Office of Afghanistan and Pakistan Affairs and USAID. And I wanted to just flip the question around, looking from the inside out, in terms of one of our big priorities for the transition is integrating Afghanistan more into the regional economy. And I was just wondering if you could comment to the extent to which your program has engaged the trade machinery. As you know, we're working with the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry of Commerce to promote accession to the World Trade Organization. We're also working with the Ministry of Customs on improving their customs efficiencies and procedures. So I just wanted to ask if you could comment briefly on how, again, your program has interfaced with the machinery within Afghanistan. Thanks.
Great question. And next to you.
Hi, Jason Kennedy from the International Stability Operations Association. Curious about the volume necessary to make this kind of a worthwhile model for GSA to use. You know, I believe Ken mentioned the sunset of, you know, major U.S. military operations within the next 2 to 3 years. And so I'm wondering, as we look to apply this model to other countries, to other supply chains, is there a tipping point in volume that's necessary to make it cost effective? And then just kind of an add-on to that, I don't think I've ever seen a government agency and a contractor look so comfortable on the dais together. And so I'm wondering if you're trying to capture those lessons as well through the process that seems to be working and disseminating those throughout the government. Thank you.
Let me touch your first question on the cost effectiveness. Part of the draw for doing this obviously was supporting the overall objectives of the Department of Defense as our major kind of stakeholder in this. But also internally within GSA, we're constantly looking for new ways, new business models to provide effective supply support to the people we need to around the world. The model we built here is actually a very thin layer of administration. There's not a whole lot of investment in it. We did some IT changes, but generally speaking, we have no physical assets. Generally speaking, it's just the contract costs for, you know, what we pay TWI to manage the supply chain for us. All the rest of it's already kind of sunk costs or costs we would be spending anyway. So in terms of cost effectiveness, this is not an expensive additional cost. The incremental cost to operate this is very, very minimal. So the answer is basically not a whole. I mean, we could do this on very small, you know, one commodity set if we had to. We would obviously have a different contract structure that would recognize that. But the model itself is not very resource intensive. Ken, is there anything you want to add to that?
What we're also comparing it to for these commodities are items that are presently coming out of distribution centers that are here that are labor intensive. And what we're essentially doing is switching to a direct vendor delivery So there's a little bit of taking a distribution point out of the supply chain cost. So that works to our advantage if we're talking pricing. In terms of, you know, applying it elsewhere and so forth, yeah, we're certainly looking at each other and saying, okay, well, you know, maybe this will work somewhere else. We haven't gotten to the sophistication of saying how much business would you need, but I would note that GSA already, and for some years, has had small inventories sprinkled around the world, different places, DOD host sites. And, you know, it occurs to us, well, gee, maybe we should be buying more of that locally. You know, if this turns into a way of doing things, we're certainly learning some skills that would work with that. There were a lot of questions that just came in those three people, and I want to make sure we don't miss them all. You were asking about the statistics. I was quickly looking. I think maybe the best we can do here is just kind of give perspective weighting, how much proportionally, rather than try to cite dollar volume. So Kazakhstan's number one, right?
I can answer that. In terms of spend per country, we're looking around 51% spent in Kazakhstan, 39% spent in Georgia, and close to 9% in Uzbekistan. There is a little bit over 1% spent in Kyrgyzstan, and very minor 0.3% spent in Tajikistan.
And we'll go ahead and add in. We'll add in the discussion on manufactured versus distributed sources in that conversation. In Kazakhstan, obviously, you're absolutely right that the toner cartridges is a large portion of the spend we have in Kazakhstan. And I don't have the exact number with me. I want to say it's $8 or $9 million. Could be even 9.1. So I was in the ballpark. So obviously they don't manufacture HB toner cartridges in Central Asia. So that's kind of a forced solution. We're buying the rest of that spend. I'd say the majority of the rest of the spend is actually manufactured sources. We're talking toilet paper,
paper towels
are actually the two very large bulk items. Again, low dollar volume, tremendous amounts of low dollar cost, tremendous volume that we're doing in those. So
a lot of cleaning supplies as well.
In Uzbekistan, it's 100% manufactured. We did like roughly, I'm going to say it's about $3 million in Uzbekistan last year, and it was 100% manufactured sources, and that's just the different business environment in Uzbekistan makes it very difficult for companies to import products and then re-export them. So basically everything we buy in Uzbekistan is made in Uzbekistan. Tajikistan, there's just not a lot of manufacturing there that for the products we purchase. However, we're starting to look into some textile products, and they're very up in the north in the Fergana Valley, some very rich, you know, cotton growing region, and there's some really nice textile products that we're going to start purchasing this year, so that'll increase. And then Kyrgyzstan, also not a lot of manufacturing there. However, we're buying water heaters in Kyrgyzstan. It's about 50-50 split in Kyrgyzstan, manufactured versus distributors. Some of the products distributed, we're buying smoke detectors that aren't manufactured there. We're buying the hand soap and water heaters that are manufactured there. So again, pretty wide range of stuff.
Let me make one comment about capturing knowledge, and this probably does not come as a surprise. In our organization, one of the ways that we're capturing knowledge is how the information system changes are taking place, so that we're creating new coding that supports this kind of operation. And this is not the only game in town that's going on that's related to how we're doing business with vendors. And our challenge is integrating with an ever-changing DoD supply chain. So there's a flowing knowledge that builds in people, and yeah, there's some documents. But I'd say that the development of the IT systems, which gives you the capabilities of going into environments, is probably as much an important captor of knowledge as anything I could point to.
Maybe it's also speak to the Afghanistan
right. In terms of Afghanistan, to date we have not sourced any products in Afghanistan. We had looked at a manufacturer of disposable flatware there, and that solution ended up not panning out for a couple reasons, but we ended up not sourcing them there. So we haven't bought any products there. Our major interface in terms of this supply chain has been transportation. And the exact dollar amount I don't have with me, but a significant portion. Afghanistan is the, in this region, it's the most expensive to ship things. Once it hit the Afghan border, that's where the majority of the expense occurs, and security, basic security issues is generally the reason for that. So it's customs, our interface has been through customs, you know, getting products across the border, and then transporting them around. And, you know, there's hiccups, it's not an easy process, but there's been no insurmountable obstacles that have kept us from, you know, completing any shipments that we've attempted. Again, sometimes things get stuck at the border, but eventually able to kind of push through that. Boban, is there anything you want to add on the Afghan interface?
No, I think you covered it very well. The transportation span that stays in the country, it's significant, and in terms of numbers, equates to probably 70% of the spend that is going on around Central Asia, basically stays within those companies that are performing services for us in Afghanistan. And another piece is clearing the goods through customs and paying taxes to the local government. It's also a significant piece.
And the last point that Jason made, this is a. If you go back to the notes, I just went back and looked at the pre-proposal conference notes when GSA was kind of, putting out this idea of doing a service-based contract versus a supplier-based contract. And, things they were saying, there's a sense of newness around doing this. It was a new event for GSA. They have the product expertise, they got the supply chain expertise, but not necessarily the local expertise. And as Ken said, being able to manage acquisitions from an overseas acquisition center. So we both kind of went into this process with this sense of newness and having to figure out, there is no blueprint to pick up and say, well, this is exactly how you do it. And we had to collaborate a lot. And we would make recommendations based on our experience operating in the region and operating overseas, talking about consolidation points. Talking about doing joint marketing, where we have a lot of knowledge of log cap contractors and how they do their acquisition process and how they use the federal supply system. I just think the conditions of the fact that it was a new type of concept, it's different than what DOD or DLA or some of the other agencies were doing. We're forced to spend a lot of time together saying, gee, this is a tough thing. What are we gonna do about this Uzbek export challenge? How are we going to overcome that? Because that's going to kill the whole initiative. All right, well, let's get creative and come up with ideas. We've been able to sit down. We did a workshop in March. We brought both of the log cap contractors operating in Afghanistan and their main supply, the managers that run their supply chains. These are huge supply chains. We were able to bring them in and do a joint workshop, roll up our sleeves with a tough customer. I mean, these guys are they're tough and they're professional and they know what they want and, get feedback and put together solutions. And I think when you can face one of your toughest customers together and do it in a unified way, that's proof that you got good integration going on. And I think overall just the structure of the contract is conducive to collaboration and partnerships because we're not incented to do anything other than collaborate, really.
And we came into this very humbly. I mean, we knew that we didn't know a lot about Central Asia, so we needed to hire a company to help us, fill in the gaps. We know supply chain. We know how to buy things in the U.S. and move it around the world. As Ken said, we don't know how to buy in Central Asia, and we knew that TWI did. So, I mean, there's a kind of a built-in incentive that we need their help to make, our joint objective successful.
Well, and really importantly, I think you had a conducive policy environment. I mean, you had some flexibility to operate. So the image you've left with us today is that our troops in Afghanistan are doing an enormous amount of printing in very clean environments because they have lots of cleaning supplies. But one of my reflections to Michael, to your point, is that we can invest a lot in capacity building and in training, but until there's a real operational pull and there's a real chance to actually change and shift and get feedback on what you're supplying, how you're doing it, it's really difficult to actually see the impact of those investments. So I think that's an important outcome. And we're going to capture what we've talked about today as just sort of, you know, a few lessons learned and put something out on that as well. So we'll have that out. But I want to thank you all for joining us. I want to especially thank all of our speakers from TWI and GSA for talking about this really unique partnership. We really appreciate it. Thank you.